Hey everyone, welcome to the PC World Show. It is your home for tough talk about the most interesting tech topics of the week. And hey, we have hit episode 35, so that's sort of a milestone. I'm John Phillips, the editor-in-chief, and we have two executive editors today, Melissa Riofrio.
Hello.
Hey, Melissa. And Gordon Ma.
Hello.
What's up, Gordon? So, we are recording this show on December 7th. And as usual, we're also live on Facebook, and we'll be taking questions and comments from our Facebook audience. So what are we talking about today? It's pretty much a holiday potpourri. We're going to start with a look at Surface Book, the latest one, versus the latest MacBook Pro. That's a benchmarking showdown from Gordon. And then Melissa's going to fill us in on the Microsoft Home Hub, which is a competitor to, Google Home and all the stuff that Amazon does with Alexa. And then finally, we're going to get into our picks for the best and worst products of the year. Personal picks. These are not PC World endorsed picks. I'll point that out now. Oh, and then at the end of the show, we also have a right or wrong that concerns two major chip heavyweights. So there's that. But let's jump right in. Gordon, tell us about the benchmarking showdown that you conducted. And this went live as an article a couple days ago?
Yeah, a couple days ago. If you go to PCWorld.com, that's spelled PCWorld.com.
Already?
You can see the story. You know, of course, we have the tons of benchmark charts. I borrowed the current MacBook Pro 15 and the two MacBook Pro 13s that are out. So the two of them are touch bars and one is non-touch bar. I just happen to have the brand new Surface Book, you know, with performance base, as they're now properly calling it, rather than initially calling it the Surface Book i7. And I decided to see how it performs against the MacBook Pros. And of course, since we had a bunch of other PCs, I also put all of those other PCs up against the Mac too, because it's not just about the Surface Book. And for the most part, I think I understand why, you know, the Mac crowd is fairly disappointed. The Surface Book is a dual core, and you know, I sort of think it goes against the MacBook Pro 13 because they're both 13-inch laptops. That's sort of how I would generally put them against each other. It's pretty much a slaughter against the MacBook Pro 13 because you're looking at a Surface Book with a pretty decently fast GeForce GPU in it, a GTX 965M, against integrated graphics in the MacBook Pro 13. And
yeah,
doesn't matter how you cut it, it's just a beat down. Of course, the new MacBook Pro is a dual core Skylake, so it's closer there, pretty close in performance, but in the GPU side, not even fair. What's interesting though is you take the MacBook Pro 15, which has discrete graphics, and you put up against Surface Book i7. The quad core in the MacBook, you know, of course, is going to destroy a dual core and multi-threaded tasks, no surprise, but in the graphics side, That GeForce card, for the most part, is faster than the Radeon in the MacBook Pro 15 I had. To be fair to Apple, though, and to Mac fanboys, the MacBook Pro 15 I had only had the Radeon Pro 450. They have a 455 and a 460. And I didn't have those to test, but I think the 460 might definitely have been closer. But you're basically looking at Microsoft's, you know, 13-inch laptop as fast as, you know, Apple's fastest Pro 15-inch laptop.
Yeah, this was basically a battle of the flagships, like the best that Apple and the PC world could produce.
Right.
And because of choices that Apple made about the graphics that they had in the laptops and some other things, they just didn't measure up in a lot of the tests.
Right.
Although we should say, to be fair, that they did do very well in battery life.
Yeah. And I do give that to Apple. I mean, the panel they use is pretty stupendous. And of course, I say battery life versus a comparable 15-inch laptop, Windows laptop. So the XPS 15, battery life, the one I have is not great.
Yeah.
Aside from the performance tests, I mean, what are the bigger sort of like abstract issues that people need to consider? So what about price? And did this MacBook Pro have the touch bar?
Yeah, so the two of the MacBook Pros had the touch bar and then one did not. As far as the price goes, I read something on Reddit that I thought was just hilarious. And it was a link to my story. And the guy said, or gal said, hey, this is so funny because I'm used to complaining like, oh, well, you're putting a $3,000 Mac against a $2,000, Windows machine. Uh-huh. And he's like, I guess I can't complain about this because now he's complaining about like, now this is a, it's a $2,000 Mac against a $3,000,
right,
or Windows.
And the Surface Book has its own suite of cool surprise and delight features as well that you're paying extra for.
Yeah. So, I will say the one thing is like, you look at it because it was a $3,300 Surface Book. It's the top end Surface Book that they have right now. $3,300, but that is with a 1 terabyte SSD with 16 gigs of RAM. You take a MacBook Pro, and I actually have the price breakdown in my story somewhere, but you actually take a MacBook Pro 13 or a MacBook Pro 15, you throw in the 1 terabyte drives and you max out the RAM. It's not that far away. You're actually looking at the Surface Book is almost on par with the MacBook, and you're still getting touch and you're still getting pen support and a tablet mode.
So what about all the non-Surface Book PCs that were in there?
So that is, of course, that is where the PC wins, because a Surface Book is very much has become the Windows version of a Mac. It's like, holy smokes, this thing is expensive.
Yeah.
Some would say overpriced. And I can actually kind of agree with that. But you look at the performance I was getting out of the HP and the Dell and the Dells and the comparable Lenovos, they were performing every bit as good or better than the MacBook Pro 13s and the 15s.
Yeah, and these are top of the line. This is the Dell XPS 13 and 15, the HP Spectre X360. So these are really nice laptops.
Right, really nice. And they are just a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the crazy thing is you're looking at, you get a MacBook Pro 13 and you're getting performance, you're paying $1,500 or $1,600. You're getting performance of like a $1,200 PC laptop, right? You got maybe a higher res screen. Battery life is actually better on the PCs because they have lower res screens.
So that's where the real value is. So I'll ask both of you, if there is any compelling reason to buy the MacBook Pro, what is it?
Wow. that's hard to ask a PC person.
But put yourself in the position of a longtime MacBook Pro user who needs an upgrade and is seriously considering a PC, but really wants to stick with a MacBook Pro. Why?
Wow. Well, you do have some nice graphics options now. I mean, I think the real compelling reason to buy one of the new MacBook Pros is that you've been waiting for 3 years to get a new MacBook Pro, and they finally have one with a reasonably current CPU and some good GPU options.
But
that's it.
Is it the touch bar? Because I read, we're all aware of what Susie, the executive editor of Macworld, had to say about the touch bar. And it's true that we've seen similar technology on an Asus computer, I want to say. Was it Asus or was it Acer?
Razer has a...
Razer. Sorry.
Razer.
I knew it was like an kind of sound. Okay. So touch bar, what if it's just a cool feature? There's a lot of utility there. Could that be what pushes you over the edge if you don't care about performance?
Yeah. Susie Oakes really loves the touch bar, really thinks that it's improved her experience on macOS. And I can totally believe her there, because on the Windows platform, we already have had touch for a few years now. And I'm a believer too.
Well, we've had touch displays, but from the Razer, not the little touch bar-ish kind of thing. Well, let me toss the question to Gordon.
Yeah,
so, Gordon,
ahead.
If you're that Mac user that I just described to Melissa, why buy a new MacBook Pro?
I honestly, I have a hard time. And of course, I'm a hater. I admit I'm a hater. I can step out of that and I can look at it objectively. And the one for performance, you're paying. It's MacBooks are overpriced. Right. Surface Book overpriced. We get it. You're getting better price out of a PC, a Windows laptop. But the thing that kind of kills me about this generation of Macs is the keyboard.
Mm-hmm.
All three of the new MacBook Pros have the, Butterfly 2 keyboard, which for years and years and years, Mac users have said, your keyboard sucks. Macs have so much better keyboards. That you can't say that. It's like, I can't honestly believe how bad that keyboard is, and that people have are saying they've deluded themselves into thinking this is a great keyboard. Like,
okay, so you can't find a single reason to buy the MacBook Pro.
At this point, I would probably go out and buy a previous generation MacBook, frankly, because that keyboard for me, it just doesn't.
I gotta try it.
That's a burn.
It just doesn't. Well, and especially the thing is, it's not even that. It's like, okay, I guess I could live with it. But coming from where Apple has been, we make the best keyboards in the world, right? Every Mac user is like, well, I love the keyboard on my Mac, right? And like, and now you got this keyboard.
What's so bad about it?
It's got no travel. It's basically, it's like a fake keyboard, almost.
Let me flip the question to if the OEM PCs are better values, is there any reason to buy a Surface Book, Gordon, first?
It's tough. I mean, well, one, you want to show it off, right? It's like why you buy a Pixel Chromebook.
Yeah.
Like, hey,
it's
I'm
a
rich.
Flagship to be shown off. It's like a coffee table book.
That's the only reason?
The pen support is nice, but it's a little tough. I mean, I love the Surface Book, the original one when it came out. It was a different world last year. Surface Book now is a little big, like it's a little heavy. You know, it's like you're almost to the point. It's like, why don't I just get a quad core laptop? Okay. So it's a little tough. It's a little hard to justify getting a Surface Book as well.
Can you add anything or subtract anything from what you said?
Yeah, I don't think anyone's meant to buy the Surface Book unless they just really want to brag to their friends.
Right. Although they do have cheaper ones
that's kind of like, yeah. You know,
it's Apple cheap. Oh, it's Apple cheap. Yeah. But I mean, look at this price. I couldn't believe it. Like if you took a MacBook Pro 15 and you max it out, this is with a 2 terabyte drive. It's $4,300.
Yeah. It's a lot of money.
Okay. Let's take this to Facebook Live. Adam, what do we got?
There's some discussion around the importance of touch. We have Doug in the chat saying that, nobody cares about the touch bar and who really uses a touch display on a PC. I mean, how do you guys feel about that?
I'll take it first. I use the touch display all the time on my computer. And I'm actually on this computer too. I don't use it when I have the full size desktop keyboard in front of me, but I use touch a lot when I'm just using the laptop's keyboard. You sort of have to get in the habit, but once you do, you rely on it.
Yeah, and I gotta agree. I when I don't have touch, I really do miss it because, sometimes you just want to scroll it up half an inch, and I don't have to think about it. I don't have to like put my finger on the trackpad, figure out where the cursor is, and whatever, and you just grab the screen, you move it. You know, it's like you have touch on your phones, you touch on your tablets. There's really no reason not to have touch at this point.
Melissa, yeah.
Well, sometimes using the trackpad is a pain. You know, it's really annoying. You got to do something with a button. I am so used now to just like expanding an image by just doing that on my screen. It just feels so natural. And I think the way that people responded to tablets and phones going to touch is answer enough for why having touch on a full PC is a good thing.
It does make your screen messy, but we'll take that. Okay, well, let's move forward. And topic two is Microsoft's Home Hub. We wrote about this week or end of last week?
End of last week.
But tell us what's going on.
All right. Yeah. There is a rumor from Windows Central that Microsoft is developing an alternative to Google Home and Amazon Alexa called Microsoft Home Hub. It's all rumors. We don't really know anything, but what Windows Central appeared to glean from some mysterious source is that this Home Hub would try to do all the same things that these other competitors do, but possibly only as a software service that would run on other devices, not dedicated devices like Google Home or Alexa. And that also it would have a special version of Cortana called, or I should say codenamed, Famtana. I know.
Wait, Famtana?
I know, whatever.
Just a code name.
Just a code name, people, that would supposedly, be more family oriented, maybe recognize different people's voices, which I understand is an issue with some of the current competition.
Google Home does not yet do that. Google Home still responds to Google Home commercials and Google Home on Modern Family it applied to, which was great product placement. Was it this last week? So Yeah, it would be nice if Cortana, or if any one of these digital assistants, could separate different family member voices. Also, isn't there something in there about calendaring, which is not yet available on Google Home? Like, you cannot set a calendar entry if you have a Google Home device, but it sounds like from what Mark Hockman wrote, this would work.
Yes. Part of the deal with this Home Hub and Famtana is that it's a shared service, and that would include things like a shared calendar, which I think a lot of families would love to have.
Right. It also, for me, harkens back to, was it the Family Hub refrigerator that Samsung showed at that might be the wrong name, but Samsung brought it out at CES last year, where everyone could share the same calendar and whiteboard on their refrigerator. So there seems to be like this motivation to create these shared software services across, you know, for the whole family. But I mean, I got to ask Gordon. So you have, a nuclear family. Would you guys use it?
We already, most families with kids is, growing kids, everybody uses Google Calendar, and it looks like, I don't know, it looks like the board at LaGuardia or a busy airport. And there's just like 50 million things on it all the time. I think it'd be cool if we're on a refrigerator, like you had a screen that had it. My idea was you actually had a e-ink calendar. So you could just hang on a wall, you charge it every 3 months, and you could just look at it to see your calendar.
Yeah.
But I don't, if we're talking about the Microsoft Home Hub thing, I honestly have any use for it.
I was just going to say, what I would love to see is families fighting over which video they're going to stream, next, by, shouting at Cortana all at the same time and having Famtana have to decide who takes precedence.
So it's kind of funny because I have a lot of, gadgets and toys, but I don't get the whole hub thing. So this is the Google, this is like Microsoft's version of the Glade thing that.
We need to ask John. How's it been for you to have Google Home?
So I use it for a shopping list. So you could just add to your shopping list right away. I use it for random facts. I've used it for weather reports. I probably haven't used it as much as they probably expect people to use it. But it's, it works pretty well. It's really good for some things. You do get a number of, non-answers, like, I don't know that at this time. But again, you can't send texts yet. You can't set calendar items yet. You can't have it check email. So there's a lot of things it can't do. Like I said earlier, it can't differentiate. It doesn't know individual voices. So anyone who speaks into it can get a response, and you could turn off the microphone so that it's muted. But, once you bring the whole family into it, I guess there's more people in interacting with it. So a product like this would probably get a lot more use. But when you brought up this idea of people fighting for what's streaming, and then I thought of what might be happening at Gordon's house, I got to ask Gordon, you probably have, everyone's at least on two different devices. You're not only using a single device.
Yeah. I mean, nobody really watches television anymore. So everybody's doing something else. So it's not really a problem.
Your kids don't watch movies or
they don't watch television. I mean, I cut the cable cord years and years ago. And we don't really
watch. What do you do?
Well, there's, video games, honestly, and there's other, mostly video games, but then there's Netflix on a laptop or Netflix on a tablet.
So you get video and you might even be watching TV shows, but you don't have cable.
No cable. And there's once in a while we'll do, hey, family movie night. And then we sit around this thing, big screen thing called the television. But that's like, hey, we're going to have a campfire.
That's what I was talking about. Yeah. Although then it also occurred to me, like, how would something like Famtana handle, like, Can it stream different things to different devices, and how would it juggle that?
What I don't understand, so why do we even give a damn about this? I mean, this is an Amazon Echo, you got Google Home, but I mean, what's in it for anybody besides selling you more crap?
I mean, the way I look at it is, it's a new category, and you know, the major companies want to get into a new category. It's a new category that works relatively well. Like with so many different devices that just completely fall down on their product promises, these Alexa devices, so Echo and Echo Dot and Google Home, they, you know, in many ways they deliver on their promises, especially when it comes to controlling smart home objects. So turning on lights or turning on or adjusting my Nest thermostat, it works really well. So you know, everyone's trying to figure out what the next big thing is, and these work. They're not perfect, but they do work well.
So the attempt is to make the movie Sci-Fi House, where you walk in and it does all this stuff. And
yeah, Jetsons.
Yeah. So the question with this rumored Home Hub is, you know, when is it going to come out and what's it really going to be? At the end of the story, they're saying 2017 or 2018, but maybe just as a service or maybe on an all-in-one, because everyone needs another all-in-one PC. So my question coming out of all these rumors is, well, first of all, Microsoft, you're a little late. And how are you going to get this on people's devices? I mean, look what happened with Windows Phone or even Windows tablets.
Well, if it's on Windows computers, I would hope that it can go on any Windows computer that you might use as a family computing device.
Yeah. And so, you know, that assumes that the family is going to have a family computing device, you know, maybe one of these new Pavilion Waves or something that's supposed to hang out in your living room. And of course, you can already summon Cortana from across the room from your PC.
You know, they'll make one of those cylinder PCs that we talked about a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Hey, let's take this to our Facebook audience. Adam, what's brewing?
You know, Doug in the chat is, and a couple other people are very, not into the name, you know, and how ubiquitous Hub is, you know, what does that even mean? I mean, what do you guys think it should be named, assuming that they're not going to stick with Microsoft Home Hub?
Well, and assuming Famtana will go away at some point, please, Microsoft.
Please. Name, God.
Please.
Boy, what would be...
They want to have Home in it, so then what do you do?
It should just be Microsoft Home. Is there already a product called Microsoft Home?
I don't think so.
Google Home, Microsoft Home.
They should just call it Computer.
Or they can call it Cortana. Get rid of Famtana. Just Cortana. They got, you know.
That's true. Yeah. They already have a name.
Okay. Anything else on this? Okay. So, hey, now we're going to talk about our most favorite and least favorite products of the year. Let's start with our favorite products and we'll go boom, boom, boom. Melissa, what's your favorite product of the year?
So I cover Chromebooks, and so my favorite product of the year is the best Chromebook I reviewed, which is the HP Chromebook 13. This came out 4 or 5 months ago, and it's the second nicest Chromebook after the Google Chromebook Pixel, which no one can afford. The HP Chromebook 13 is somewhat more affordable, and it's a beautiful aluminum, you know, encased Chromebook with, you know, nice display, nice keyboard. The click pad, maybe not much better than any other click pad, but I hate all click pads, so no big deal there. The big deal, I think, about the HP and a few other Chromebooks that have come out in the last year is that they actually are good laptops. And having covered Chromebooks now for 3 or 4 years, I cannot tell you how many craptacular Chromebooks I have had to suffer through that had crummy screens, crummy keyboards, crummy cases, crummy everything. You just wanted to throw them out the window. And now I would say that there's at least a handful of Chromebooks that I'd be willing to recommend to someone. And other than that, all the other Chromebooks are the worst.
Okay. And how much does it cost?
Well, there are a bunch of different configurations. I think the one that we reviewed cost $899.
Ooh, okay. That's a lot of, that's an expensive, chunk of change to not have a Windows computer, but, there's reasons to buy a Chromebook, and that's the best, according to Melissa. Gordon, what do you have? Let me stop. Also, I want to hear from the audience what your favorite products of the year are. But let's go to Gordon.
Yeah. You know, I really wanted to pick, cause HP Spectre X360, the redesign is like it's just an awesome redesign. It really makes for portable, fast, you know, laptop. I'm like, I really would like to run it for a few months to see what it's like. But I really wanted to pick that as the best product of the year. But I also wanted to really encourage, to give credit to Intel for the Core i7 6950X. So that is Intel's 10-core CPU, Broadwell E, 10 cores. Now, the reason I want to give them credit is, you know, we've gone from, you know, 6 cores in the high end to 8 cores, and we've now gone to 10 cores. No one really needs it. Very few people really need it, honestly, but I just want to give credit to Intel for having a 10-core consumer CPU.
And it's $1,500?
Yes, which is, I'll talk about
that's
later.
That's all.
So it's the cost, it's more expensive than most of the notebooks you're ever going to buy. But they did 10, not 8. Mo cores, as Gordon would probably say.
You got to, come on, you're advancing. You got to
advance the ball down the field. Okay, remember, we still want to hear your favorite products of the year. I'll talk about mine now.
Well, wait, Gordon didn't have a worst.
Oh, we're going worst.
Oh, sorry. After. Oh, so I was out of step. Sorry.
we're gonna look at worsts after we hear from the audiences on their bests. My favorite product of the year was the Pixel XL specifically. So if you follow me or if you follow the show, you know that I'm an Android phone user and that I've always been a Nexus phone user. The Pixel XL really does feel like the first Google phone that is serious about marrying software to hardware in an elegant, consistent way. It's somehow so much faster than all the other Android phones. It just feels fast. It responds fast. It's simpler than any other Android phone, including the Nexus phones. Meaning, so they've done a great job in removing the stuff that you probably don't need, and pushing to the fore the stuff that you do need. It's full of a lot of cool surprise and delight features, like really cool live wallpapers, and of course Google Assistant, which I'm now using more than any other part of the interface. So I think they've done a great job. The camera's awesome. When we were shooting Thanksgiving photos, like everyone agreed, my phone should be, this is over iPhones, my phone should be the one to take, you know, the family shots because it's better photography.
What did the iPhone users say?
You know, they're not that, they weren't very sophisticated iPhone users, so they're just sort of rolled over on it. So that's good. But I still go back to when my stepmom saw the, not this startup sequence, but the Nexus startup sequence, and she's like, oh, what is that? Like, she was totally impressed with the sort of very colorful Nexus 6P startup sequence. So props to Google for the Pixel XL. That's my favorite product of the year. Okay, Adam, any questions or suggestions on other products?
Yeah, we got some, we definitely have some favorites. Over on YouTube, because we're starting up on YouTube now.
Hey, YouTube.
I'm going to have a hard time with his name. Wang.
Just
Yang Wei Hong says he loves his ThinkPad P70 as a laptop. Keith says he loves the RX 480 for his GPU
choice. That's the well-priced budget.
Yeah.
One.
Yeah.
That's nice.
There's so many contenders.
that was a good call on that AMD chip. Anyway, please proceed.
And then Doug on Facebook says any VR ready 7th generation workstations. So he's leaving it pretty broad.
Cool. Well, those are pretty hardcore choices, and very, something about those choices suggested a very knowledgeable audience too. So I appreciate that. You guys have any comments on those picks?
RX 480 is a great deal.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, and then the thing is, the RX 480 originally was, it was like a $300 card because you couldn't find it, but now they're $200 and a little under. It's like,
sweet.
That is a hell of a lot that you're getting for $200.
That's what I'll get to play my one PC game of the year. But I could find time. I'll find time during the holidays. Okay. So now we're going to switch to our least favorite products of the year, the worst products of the year, whatever you want to call it. Melissa, what do you got?
So as I referred to, almost any Chromebook under $180 is probably pretty bad.
Okay. So huge variance there.
Yeah. It's unfortunate because you want them to be affordable and attainable, but oh my God, they're so awful. Most of them. Beware if you go under $180, $170, it's probably pretty bad.
You do have to be careful when you're picking them out, right? I mean, some of them are just...
You do. There are a couple around 200, under 200 that are actually decent. I reviewed one this year, but the rest of them, ugh, yuck.
All right. Gordon, do you have a least favorite?
Yeah, this may sound familiar, but I think the least favorite would be the Core i7-6950X, Intel's 10-core CPU. Now, hear me out. I know you just heard me say 10 minutes ago that, yes, the Core i7-6950X is the most awesome CPU because it's a 10-core CPU. And now it's also the worst because the price, it's not $1,500, John and Melissa. It is actually, it came out at $1,723.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. So, yes, I mean, it's awesome. We're getting 10 cores. We're moving down the field, but we've paid $130 million for Colin Kaepernick is what's happening. I'm a Raiders fan, so who cares?
You don't care. The Raiders are looking great. So, what kind of OEM wins does that 10 core have?
Oh, well, everybody's using them because
just in the honestly, upper echelon boutique PCs.
You know, to the people who buy super high end, you know, $8,000, $10,000, $12,000 PCs, what the hell? He's like, oh, this costs more money? Those customers, they're like, I want it. And they're like, yeah. Well, no, it costs too much. It was like, that's why I want it. I mean, right. I'm made of money.
Because
right?
When you're that rich, you're like, I got to spend my money on something.
Yeah, you want to spend it on something. And honestly, when somebody says like, well, no, this is crazy pricing, those people don't. They're like,
just so show how popular, how important PC gaming is.
It's, yeah, and they actually, I will say every time I go to Intel, every year on their extreme products, their high end, I mean, they've always been $1,000, which is like, you really are getting not that much more for your for the extra $500 that you're paying for most people, but they always say we are selling them by the truckloads. We outsell what we expect every time we forecast this many, and people always want more.
In 1996, when Gordon and I were on Boot Magazine, and Intel didn't respect that market, or just like, oh, okay, you know, we're creating powerful CPUs, but they didn't care about PC gaming right back then. And now look at it. Intel needs you and us.
So, yes.
So, okay. So, again, we want to hear about your worst products of the year, the big product fails of the year. I'll share mine. It's a product that I only spent about half a day with, but it's the Note 7. We liked it when it came out. It got a 4.5 stars, and boy, man, it went up in flames figuratively and literally. What a huge product fail. I mean, that we're going to do a wins and fails of the year as a year-end story. That's got to be lead fail
That's
of the
year. That's the fail of the
year. Man, they blew it. They really screwed that up bad.
Yeah, that's just, there's nothing you could, like, you feel bad kicking it around because it's just like, it's, you can't even make fun of it. You feel guilty. It's like, it's too easy.
Yeah. I wish we didn't send ours back. If we had not sent ours back, I would build like a metal and glass case and have that thing and put it inside the case and have it continually powered. And I'd have a webcam just pointed at it. And just, you know, waiting for it to explode. That would be some cool performance art.
We should buy one on eBay. I'm sure they're like,
yeah, they're 9,000. Pretty expensive though.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Okay. So Adam, do we have some worst products of the year from our audience?
Yeah, we actually have a couple more best.
Okay.
As well.
We'll take them all.
The worst, we got QWERTY over at Facebook, says any Chromebook. so throwing some shade over at Melissa. Chris says the Pebble 2, he was disappointed by that. For stuff that people are loving, Amnar on Facebook loves his Y900 Lenovo. Is that a desktop?
Yeah, that's
laptop?
A yoga laptop.
And then on YouTube, who is it? Java's Best really loves his 1070. So
okay,
cool.
1070. Yeah.
1070. A lot nice.
I mean, you're getting a lot for what they used to charge you anyway.
Okay, cool. We're just about to wrap this up. We'll end as usual with right or wrong. There's only two correct answers. It's either right or wrong. I'm going to start with Gordon on this because he could provide a little bit of background. So Gordon, right or wrong, Intel will use AMD GPUs.
Right. In fact, I wrote about it this morning that there is a very strong indications that Intel has and will sign a deal with AMD to essentially possibly replace the graphics inside of its CPUs with Radeon graphics, or at least AMD design graphics. There's a very good chance of that. The other possibility is, no, they just, you know, sign a patent protection from AMD to protect them from lawsuits from everybody. But I honestly do feel that they are going to do it. We are going to see AMD Radeon inside of Intel CPUs.
Is it because AMD is so diminished by now that that Intel feels it's not even really a competitive threat?
I think that's part of it. So, Intel is just down the road from NVIDIA. NVIDIA, by the way, if people don't know, Intel has been paying NVIDIA, you know, $200 to $300 million a year for the last 6 years over a lawsuit that the two were involved with. And that is coming to an end. Intel basically needs like some protection for any graphics IP that they could be sued for. And if they sign a license with AMD, it protects them. And honestly, this comes back to my Game of Thrones thing. This is because people are like, that's impossible. There's no way AMD's ever gonna come, you know, work with Intel. But
yeah,
you know what? Who's more of a threat to Intel? AMD, who's basically selling off buildings to keep, you know, things running, or NVIDIA, that's building a brand new building from scratch, and they're inside Tesla. They've got all this cool stuff happening. They have machine learning and all that. It's just, you know, better to give AMD $250 million a year than it is to give it to their competitor just down the road.
Makes sense. Melissa, right or wrong, Intel will use AMD GPUs?
Well, just to make it exciting, I'll say wrong. It probably is going to happen. I wasn't sure if you were asking, is it like, factually right or wrong, or is it morally right or wrong?
I meant,
you know, and
the chances, like odds, will it happen?
We'll never work with the Lannisters.
You know, and I think when we first got wind of this story, you know, the first thing you think about is dogs and cats living together, and how could Intel and AMD possibly ever cooperate on anything? There are a lot of good reasons why this probably will and should happen. Intel does need an out after becoming free of NVIDIA, and AMD is available and could use some money. And that's what Intel has. Intel has money, but it doesn't have great graphics. The reason I think it's wrong is because it puts Intel and AMD really close in bed together. And one of the historical imperatives of Intel and AMD's relationship is that they had to be competing so that Intel basically wouldn't be accused of running a monopoly. And it actually was in Intel's interest to keep AMD somewhat competitive. It's even shorted up a couple of random times in the past just to make sure that it had some competition. And when you talk about things like the 10-core chip and the price of that chip, it shows you why Intel needs competition to keep those prices down. And one of the things that we were looking forward to personally is the Zen CPU from AMD, which is supposed to be pretty hot, and that would maybe put some pressure on Intel's high-end CPUs and bring those prices down so that we can all have cheaper, faster computers. And so while I do see that this could probably happen, I worry that we're going to lose some competitiveness, and, you know, suddenly it's going to be like the airlines where we're all squished into these little seats because they don't have any competition.
Okay. Right or wrong, I'll ask myself. It's right. They will work together, and that is going to be the end of the PC World Show. So I want to thank everyone for joining us. Thanks, Melissa.
It was great.
And thanks, Gordon.
See ya.
And come back next week, which will probably be the last PC World Show of the year.